live, you are live.
Have a look at that fog that is coming over Djuma this morning, and the sun is rising, the beautiful colors of yellow in the distance there with this old knobthorn tree. It is a fantastic morning to be starting our day with Safari Live, and this morning you'll have David behind the camera, Samuel Chevalier as your presenter, Elvis the Ellie guiding you along your ways out here. And there was reports by our lovely viewers around a jackal by the dam. How cool is that? I still haven't seen a jackal. Hopefully we can see a jackal today. We're going to move down that way and see if we can have the opportunity to see it. Otherwise, you heard lions last night. I also heard lions last night. I woke up and I didn't know what was going on, and then I just heard lions roaring and I was like, oh, whoa. So they're very close to camp, and that was very, very exciting to hear that. So they're going to... I thought they were coming from the sandy patch area. So Jamie is now in that direction. She's going to go look in that area, see what she can find. And I'm going to go in this direction and see if I can find anything that might be lurking around the dam this morning. So it's going to be an exciting morning. Or it's going to be whatever it is. We don't know because it's live. We never know what's going to happen on Safari Live. We just can only enjoy the beautiful sunrises, sunsets, and the interactions with wilderness as it comes. So let's get going on our venture forth and take a last few moments to take in that beautiful morning. You can't get this, it's just too special when you wake up to this. And to the sounds of different birds. I've already heard hardy-dars going and some of the doves. There was the thickney. There was a full-spotted owlet. So the chorus of birds to the beauty of the sunrise. Nature is welcoming us into this beautiful day. As I said, it was 13 degrees Celsius, so it's a little bit chillier than yesterday. 56 degrees Fahrenheit. So it is a chilly morning. Yes, I had my big beanie on. This morning I don't. But that's just the way it works sometimes. My ears must just get cold. There's some impala just over here. I'm just going to get into a position where it's more comfortable for Dave to view them. Here we go. You can see the thick coats of the impala. Ooh. Brian Deere is quite interested to know what makes that deep, almost the growling sound that you are interested in. Well, of course, you know, the guttural, it's a guttural sound. So the impala make a very, very strong sound when they're in the rut season. So it's so difficult to try and do it myself. I'm going to see if I can find that impala that is rutting and hear if we can hear that sound. So I'll do my best to find that this morning. At the moment we can just see females here, but just as we look at these impala, have a look at this nyala that's just to the left of us. So we've started our morning to a beautiful looking impala group, and now we've got this male nyala that has such a beautiful coat. So it's quite a mature bull. You can see by that, by the horns and by the lovely coating on that nyala. So isn't that exciting? What's interesting here though is that the impala are all looking down as if they've heard something. Some of them are, at least. So potentially, if we stroll down this little hill, we might be able to find out what might be lurking away from the impala and the nyala. And as we get into the cold mornings, we're going to find more of the plain species coming together in groups, like the zebra, the impala, and the many, or giraffe, many different plains game. And that's when it's going to be really cool to wake up to all these animals on the open areas, because it's much safer for them to be on the open areas at night time, as it gives them that advantage of security. So we're coming down towards the watering hole, Djuma Dam. I'm just going to look to see if we can see anything that might be lurking. It is still quite dark. I'm just going to switch off my vehicle as we roll down here. Just in case there could be anything lurking and we can't hear it. So there doesn't seem to be any sign of jackal at the moment. I wonder what time it was that you saw that jackal. It's incredible that you saw a jackal here. Very excited for whoever saw that this morning. Djuma Dam is looking very empty over there. Let's see if we can find some tracks of anything. So it's fairly quiet down by the dam. I couldn't hear any sound of lions roaring in the distance. But we'll pay attention to all the different sounds as we carry on. So my co-pilot this morning, or co-pilots, is Jamie and James. So let's go to Jamie and see how she's doing on this very cold morning.
I quite like that description of being a co-pilot. It's very entertaining. But a good morning to you all. My name is Jamie and I have Jandre on camera with me on this lovely freezing cold, chilly, Arctic themed sunrise safari. I'm exaggerating slightly. It's not that cold. I'm pretty cold though. Jandre looks pretty cold at the back as well. And he's getting the full force of the wind chill factor. It's not that cold. It's in the low 50s Fahrenheit, but with the wind chill, it does feel a lot colder. I hear that a lot of you are letting us know about the lions at Arathusa Dam. So basically, probably where we left them, if indeed it is the Savannah still. We had them yesterday afternoon on the sunset safari. It looked as though they were thinking about hunting a baby hippo. There you go, this is for Sam, who's looking for noisy ratting impala. There you go. Brian, dear, isn't that bizarre? Such a strange sound for an antelope to make. You're wondering about what animal makes that sound? A rutting impala. So basically what he's doing there is he is intimidating all of the other males in the area, as well as sort of letting the ladies know that he is in peak and fine condition. And therefore capable, I guess, of producing that bizarre groaning, grunting sound that they make. And I remember the first time I heard it as a small child, I was convinced. I think I was in the Kruger. And in the rest camps in Kruger, you often see a lot of and at that point, I was quite convinced I was about to be eaten by a leopard. Until I realized that it was in fact an impala, a leopard or a lion. They're very... out on foot and...
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the warming part of this chilly morning. It's 13 degrees Celsius. My name is James Henry on camera. From the angle you can see is the enormous Brian Joubert. Hello. Hello, Brian. And we're standing here with Anyala, who was, until very recently, standing just 3 meters from us. And I don't know if it's the fact the light has yet to sort of fully filter into the earth this morning, but he was completely relaxed with us. He just kind of watched us come up, ate a bit, and then he wandered off down to where he's eating now. He is doing a dance. Yes, he is. Brian, should we move in here? He's doing his dressage dance, everybody. That's his, it's not actual dressage. He just looks like dressage. He's showing the other male. There are two other males through here, and they're showing each other how very big and strong they are. Might also be the intimidating size of B. Joubert that is creating the dressage. Look, he's kind of coming out now. Go back a bit. I mean, we're probably about 150 meters out of camp, So we're right there. And he's horning the tree a bit. He is eating it, but he was horning the base of one of the trees there. That leaves his scent. They're not strictly territorial. They will sort of leave their own scent in an area where they like to be. This is a fantastic Nyala sighting, everyone. I mean, we're now, what, for 20 meters from him, Brian? And he's completely unreactive to us. You won't get anywhere near this close to something like an impala out in the bush, a zebra, a wildebeest. Forget it. And I think it's because these chaps live quite close to the camp, so they're very used to human presence, so they don't worry too much about us when we walk. Oh, look, Brian. Is he doing what I think he's doing?
Yeah.
The usual story.
The usual story.
So every time I look at an animal, it relieves itself. It's quite a sort of a disconcerting thing to see. That Nyala is no different. And Voisia Hippie, you want to know, is that a Nyala dance? That is absolutely a Nyala dance, and he's doing it again. We come through here. What we can do is we can see the white mantle. If you look underneath this bush, you can see the white mantle on his back is standing up. And that's an indication that he's about to do his little dance or that he's just done it. See how slowly he's walking? He doesn't have arthritis. That's just part of the dance that they do. And you can hear the Franklin in the background, sort of complaining. There we go. They always sound so very surprised with what the life has to throw at them. That'll be a crested Franklin. That's a very nice start to the morning, I must say. He's doing a fantastic dance. And the others don't seem to be responding. See how he's flicked up that white tail tip? That is amazing. I think this is our most beautiful antelope. The other two in this area, I'm just going to narrate to you what they're doing because Brian's showing you that one doing his dance. They're just watching us. They're not responding to him at all, which is quite interesting. There's another one, a younger one. Now watch the mantle on... Can you see the other one? Mm-hmm. Watch the mantle on that one's back. Let's see if it stands up. If he too decides that it's necessary to do some dawn dressage. Seemingly not. There was a lot of bird song this morning. It's a totally clear morning, of course, so the sun is going to come up and it should warm up quite nicely from what is quite a chilly start to our morning. There are doves and orioles and grey-headed bush shrikes going. Franklin's, obviously. Red-billed buffalo weavers and drongos and sparrows. Woodpeckers. It's just amazing. And the sounds of impala, who I suspect are wasting their time rutting. I think that the mating has already occurred in this last week. Well, that's a brilliant start. Then, Brian, once you're done there, I have something interesting to show you over here. We'll just keep moving around these Nyala. Amazingly, they just are not reacting to us at all. And I'm sure it's because of the proximity to the camp. But, Brian, if you try and get an angle on this unbelievable latticework of a tropical tent web spider... And I think that the dawn light caught in these strands is always very beautiful. And I can actually see Can I see the spider? I can't actually see the spider. But there's quite an interesting thing here. There is an orb web. There's a very cross impala there. There is an orb web as well as this kind of a, well, Brian, you'll recognize this sort of trapeze net underneath here, right? A little bit like a trapeze net. So there's the trapeze net you can see underneath there. Normally the spider will live in the sort of inverted funnel that is in the middle of the web there. And the intricacy of this is unbelievable. Each strand is probably about a millimeter apart. A millimeter doesn't have an imperial equivalent, as far as I'm aware. Very, very little, small fraction of an inch. And then over here, there is another spider that is living in the same web, but is a different species. And it is a very small orb web spider. So an orb web spider will create the sort of traditional spider's web that you know of, and sort of vertically arranged with the, what do we call them, the roundy bits. But it's vertically arranged. My vocabulary has left me this morning. And the tent web spider, his is completely inverted like that, and he has a horizontal arrangement. So that's not the same spider that's living there. And I don't actually see the tropical tent web spider here. They are very small, obviously, otherwise they wouldn't be able to create such an amazing intricacy of strands. Then the last thing I want to show you here is that while it's all very well having a net, and not much is just going to fall into it spontaneously, so they've got this whole arrangement here of knockdown threads. And the knockdown threads are precisely as they say. When an insect flies into them, they're not particularly sticky. It just creates, they get their wings tied up, they fall down, and they fall into the sticky part, which is the trapeze nest or net at the bottom there. Amazing stuff, Brian, amazing. Right, the Nyalas have moved off. And so I think that we will also make our way off. Now, Lucy, you very kindly are concerned about my stick and the fact that I had lost it the other day. As with most of the things that I lose, Lucy, I found it in my room. This is embarrassing, of course. Let us head off across the clearings here. We'll head down to the south of the reserve to start with, and then we'll see whether we're going to turn west or east. We may just see if we don't find one or two tracks of the Queen and see if she has come back towards these parts. Oh, it is a perfect, perfect morning, and we'll get into a position where we can watch the sun come up. There's some impala, Brian, just running across the plains. I'm sure those are the ones that were shouting at us. All shouting at each other, the males making that totally incongruous roaring sound. Alrighty, we're going to continue to the south. Sam is somewhere knocking about the place. Let's head across to him and see if they've found anything interesting.
So we are back here in the drainage line, very chilly down here, I tell you that. And we are looking to see if we can find anything down here. We saw some lion tracks, but they seem fairly old. So what we decided to do is just to drive next to the drainage line, just for the next while, to see if we can locate on any sound cores or alarm cores of any animals that might be quite scared of a predator around here. And just kind of pick up on any signs. So we've seen some tracks, now it's time to hear some different sounds out here in the bush. And I've just been told that you just saw a Nyala bull, a dominance display. It's the same, must have been the same Nyala we saw this morning. That's very cool. So now James is on foot with that in Nyala. It's very cool how they do that, how they stand up their hair on the back of their, or on their backs. It's always very, very interesting behavior that you really get with in Nyalas. Very, very incredible, endemic to this area. And well, they're also up in Pinda, but you don't get you don't get, we just got some good news. I don't know what it might be. Let's go and have a look to see what Jamie's got.
There we go. We knew we'd heard them from somewhere. Jean-André said Gallagher shortcut, I said Sandy Patch Road, and we found them in the middle. Or at least we found this one male on Aubrey's Road. Very, very close to where we had that sighting of Tingana, and also it's a Tsakani in this particular area. So, it's a nice way to start the morning, and hopefully he continues to vocalize. I can only see one male at the moment. I don't see any others, but he could well lead us across to the rest of them. Looks like a Birmingham boy, from what little I can see of him, but let's go shuffle a little bit closer and have a look. Just let me communicate on the Game Drive channel. Morning, Mike. I've got one Madodangala lying up on Aubrey's Road, about 300 metres or 200 metres north of the access junction. Copy that, Mike. I wonder what he thinks of those rutting impala, and if he's ever tempted to just show them what a real male lion roar sounds like in comparison. So Ravi, you were wondering if the Tsalalas were calling last night, and if so, why would they do so, since clearly they don't really want to draw attention to themselves. They are currently around Arathusa Dam, so close to the territory of the Birmingham boys, and you are absolutely right. From what I can see, or from what I would have thought, let's not disturb him from his restful slumber. I think that's about as close as we can get. So Ravi, I don't know if they were calling last night. I think the Birmingham boys were particularly vocal. I would have suspected that they wouldn't want to draw attention to themselves, but if they did, maybe they felt confident that the Birmingham boys were far enough away. Maybe they felt it necessary just to let the other lion prides in that area know that they were around. That could be one of the reasons why this Birmingham boy, if indeed it is a Birmingham boy, has come all the way across in this direction. The impala, undeterred by the lion in their midst, busy rutting and grunting away. He looks quite old, to be honest. I'm sort of double check this. I sort of automatically assumed Birmingham boy just because of where we are, but that isn't always the case, and you've got to be careful about such assumptions. Difficult to tell without looking at his teeth just how old he is. We've spoken a lot about the not the fallacy exactly, but the inaccuracy of using a lion's nose, the darkness of a lion's nose, to determine their age. But as a general rule, as a general guideline, very often lions' noses go darker as they get older. Doesn't always happen. Sometimes you get old lionesses with very pink noses, and sometimes you get young lions with very dark noses. So it's not a strict, hard and fast rule, but it is a sort of a general principle. The best way to age a lion, of course, is to look at his teeth, but unless Chandra is going to volunteer to go and do a dental inspection.
Sure.
Sure. Oh, okay, Chandra is up for it. Well, I certainly think that we'd probably increase, might go viral with that. No, I don't think I'll be sending Chandra across to have a look at his teeth.
No.
Sorry, Chandra, not today. Not today. Besides, I can't operate that camera, then who would film it? We'd have a slight problem.
Put it on a selfie stick.
Right. Selfie stick, all right. Chandra clearly has lost his mind this morning and is determined to go and inspect the teeth of that lion. I'm not sure who this is. I'm not sure which particular male it is. It's probably a Birmingham boy. But if any of you happen to know, and I'm sorry, I cannot keep this earpiece in my ear this morning. Doesn't want to stay. Stay. I have to tape it in. And Lucy from South Bend, Indiana, you were wondering if this could be the male that was with amber eyes. When was that? That was about a week, more than a week ago now. And he then moved off Djuma and towards Torchwood and onto First Rock. It could be. I never saw the male that was with amber eyes. I was not with James when he had that sighting. We know that they were together 2 days ago. But I think that what's happened, because Jandre said that he heard contact calls, so not just the broad, deep roars of lions announcing their presence to the big wide world, but also the slightly softer contact calls. So what I think is that, yes, the Birmingham boys have since split from Amber Eyes. There were, last I heard, three of them with her on Torchwood, so the property to the east of us, about 2.5 miles away from where we are now. So they'd obviously split up now. Amber Eyes looking to return to the Nkuhumas, and the Birmingham boys looking to potentially reunite as a coalition. Now, we've got some interesting aspects of the lion dynamics playing out at the moment. We've got the Tsalalas. And we'll chat a little bit more about the lion dynamics, because it could be quite a long discussion, and I want to hear what you guys all think and if we have any further information. In the meantime, we shall await the rising sun, hopefully to heat us up a little bit, and we're going to go and have a look at the sunrise from James's on-foot perspective.
I'm not sure that you'll ever get a better picture than that, everyone. The gentle demon-coloured sun glowing through a sunken mist in the great valley of the Umlilwati. And while that lion, you see, even the lion has decided that such a view cannot be enjoyed while walking about. He must be lying down and enjoying it. That picture that you're seeing there is completely unedited. I mean, there's no kind of effect we're putting on it. So what you're seeing there is what we're standing looking at now. It truly is unbelievable, watching the golden spread as that mist turns from white into that incredible kind of yellow, orange, gold. I know that I'm kind of burning the back of my retina, but I'm unable to take my eyes away from it. That really is quite something. Hey? Gee whiz. That might be one of the best I've seen. Certainly the most unusual. Alrighty, let's go back to the lion. We're going to move down towards the south, like I said, and see what we can find there.
I'm sorry. You might have just missed that. But he just sort of stretched. And you know how when you roll over in your bed and you're waking up in the morning and you stretch and you kind of go, he just did it, sorry boy, he just made the exact same sound as he stretched. He kind of tucked his paws in and went as he hugged himself. I've never heard a male lion do that before. It was highly, highly entertaining. I hope he does it again for us. It was definitely not quite befitting of the dignity of the supposed king of the jungle or king of the beasts. Those huge feet. He's looking very peaceful. So yes, lion dynamics is what we were going to chat about after you had a look at James's stunning sunset. The Salala pride have pushed up into Arathusa. They do occasionally come onto Arathusa anyway, so it might just be that that's why they just were wandering about. Home ranges of a lion or territory of a lion is not a set-in-stone thing. It's got flexible boundaries, and perhaps they just came up because they felt like it. However, the Mangeni pride, or the subadults of the Mangeni pride, or the Tsalala breakaway pride, are also out of their usual home range of Londolozi, and they've come all the way up and are now sitting at the dam at Simbombidi, a property to the northwest of us. And the Matimbas even made a very brief journey into Simbambuli, the Matimba males that were kicked out by the Birmingham boys almost a year ago. They decided to pop up north for a visit, and they went back again. And one has to wonder about what has caused these shifts in lion dynamics and what it's going to mean for the future. Personally, I actually don't think there's going to be much in the way of drama or fireworks. I think the Tsalalas might hang around Arathusa for a bit and then move back further south and disappear from our view for a while. The Elephant Plains Arathusa area has been almost a black hole in terms of prides, not male coalition territories, but in terms of prides, we've hardly seen the Nkuhumas heading across there. They've spent brief periods of time on Arathusa, but over the last few months they've maybe pushed only a little bit into that area. Other than that, they've spent most of their time around Djuma and Torchwood and Biffleshook, and mostly Djuma and Torchwood. The Styx females are further to the south, so they're south of Gowrie Main, around Cheetah and Little Gowrie, and they've got their cubs there, so they're not going to be going too far. And maybe that's why the Tsalala pride has moved up into this area. It's just because there's space. There's a vacuum in terms of pride territories, and they've taken an opportunity to come and do that. And Texan's just coming to join. Of course, you're more than welcome. He's just basically showing courtesy by asking if he can come and join us. And I'm going to have to reposition so that he can squeeze past. Oh, no, maybe not. Morning, fun. How are you? Okay. Thanks. Guys. Can you squeeze past there, Tex?
No, if it's not, then we'll just hear that you will push
me. We'll just push me out the way. Sorry, bear with me 1 second because my earpiece has now completely given up. Chandra's having a good chuckle. It's in two pieces. Just hold on 1 second while I try and fix that. Are you perfect? Oh, too many things going on at once. Multitasking here. Okay, I can hear again. You seem to be fine. Since our lion doesn't seem to be up to terribly much, let's head over to James, who has a flying insect for you.
This is a little wasp, everyone. Well, he's not that little. He's about an inch long, just under. And he has been flying around these clearings for some time, and I've wanted to get a good look at him. But of course, because he is a wasp, he will sting, or she will sting you. And this one is so cold that she can't move. She was just starting to sort of ooze about the place. I put it on my hand and then realized that I was probably going to get stung. So I then put her on my sleeve while she wakes up. There you can see a bit of movement in her feelers. And as the sun warms her up, she'll start to move around. Now she's been eating a sedge that has flowered around the clearings and also the Waltheria plants. I'm not sure which parts specifically, but that's what she's been going for. And just the incredible iridescence. I mean, she's got exactly the same colors as a Birchall starling. Right, well, I'm going to put her down before she lumas me. Let's go back to Jamie and the now mobile Birmingham lion.
We dragged you away from James because I think he's going to call. Is that it, boy? There we go. Come on. Well, was dramatic. Bud in North Carolina has suggested maybe if I you... Oh, never mind. Come on, boy. Here we go. Now we're going to get a roar. Oh, somebody's got a limp. Just wait and see if he calls. Oh, somebody's got a very sore foot. Doing some territorial marking. And Stacy. Just going to be quiet for the moment, just so that we get the full effects of the noises he's making. Hello, boy. Peekaboo. Are you looking for the rest of your buddies? Stacy, you were saying the Matimba males have been after the Mangeni pride. Could this not be the ginger Matimba male? And no, he's not big enough. Now that he's standing up, now that we've got a full view of that mane, he is definitely much younger. And isn't the same Birmingham boy I saw with a limp months ago? Looking very sorry for himself. And not really fully calling. We also had that moment when he yawned. Not, unfortunately, in response to my own yawn, but he did yawn. And we got a chance to see his teeth, so it is a young male, it's not a Matimba male. I'm just going to let Taxon go in front of me, so that he can, his guest can have a look, and then we will move around in front as well. If he does go into this block, it's going to be really very tricky for us to stay. Well, my earpiece is still in one piece. It's going to be really very tricky for us to stay with him. It's a horrendously dense block, but we'll do our utmost. And he's obviously looking for the rest of his coalition, so hopefully he leads us to them. And the answer is, the biggest advantage that a male coalition could have is the advantage of numbers. So the more lions in a coalition, the better. That being said, as with what happened with the Mapohos, a large male coalition. Oh, in we go. Maybe the lions that I heard were around Bifilsuk. So, what happened with the Mapohos was that they had a territory of around or close to, I think in the end, 15,000 odd hectares, if not larger. And the end result of that was that they split. The coalition of six males ended up splitting. In the end, that was probably what, that and age is what led to their downfall, because the Majingilanis were able to pick them off one by one in twos, or partially. I'm oversimplifying what happened there, but you sort of get the idea. And there's also attitude. There is a certain degree of personality to these wonderful big cats. Scrapper, or Tokolosh, or Tsotsi, depending on who you asked what his name was, the one Birmingham boy that recently died around Bifilsuk. He had a particular... Oh, come on, boy. That's a good call. He had a particularly interesting attitude. He was actually quite aggressive, almost, in terms of his response. As to which coalition I think is the best, I couldn't possibly say. I don't know how you define most successful, because you could have a very large territory and reproduce with a lot of females, but then at the same time, that's not going to be very successful if they can't protect and maintain those offspring and look after them and stop other males from causing them injury. So I don't necessarily see it in terms of success versus failure of coalitions. It's not really a competition. I'm just trying to see if I can't. I think taxon's going round. Oopsie. Come on, Wendy. Ah, there we go. That's where he's going. Thanks, Tex. That makes more sense. I thought that I heard more than one lion. So there's a second Birmingham boy just up ahead of us. Bethany, you're wondering if the lions had perhaps realized that with Scrapper dead, there was...
Okay.
Oh, sorry, hold on 1 second. Standing by, Greg. Oh, there he is.
Champion, I'd like to respond to that on Corby's Road, if possible.
Copy that, Greg. You're welcome to take a standby after Mike, depending on how far he is. It's a very, very thick block. I'll keep you updated.
Okay, I'm making my way. I just left the airstrip, making my way down the boundary.
Off he goes. Copy that, you can make your way in.
Great, Mike, you can make your way in, all right?
Let's try and
copy, thanks,
keep
Mike.
Up with them. They're going to go meet up somewhere close to that termite mound where we were before. Bethany, I'm going to get back to you on the answer to your question that you asked, but for now I'm just going to concentrate on getting us into a good position to follow these lines. While I do, let's go back over to Sam.
So you've just been with some male lion. You've just been, I think it's just one or two. I heard over the radio that there potentially might be another lion in that area. That's really, really exciting. We are just, let me just turn this radio down. We are at the moment at Buffleshoek Dam. So you've just reached us as we've got you. It's pretty chilly here again, and the sun is just poking its nose through the trees there. Some beautiful soft light coming on to Buffleshoek, and we're going to gently come in here to see, are there any tracks? Is there anything lurking in the bushes just before we get to the watering hole? Who knows what might be up there? Here we go. So we're coming over the thicket now. And we are now at Buffleshoek. At the moment I can't see anything. See if there's any tracks of the lion, the female lionesses. So they really do like this area. So here's the watering hole. I think it's a bit too cold, a little bit too early for any animals to be here at the moment. But that is one big watering hole. And let's go see what James is doing with a smaller one.
It's very cold down here. We're in the drainage line, a drainage line that feeds the Umlilwati. Apparently my hat is not of an acceptable standard. I just didn't want you to have to look underneath my peak cap. Anyway, we're sitting here, let me start again. We're sitting here in a drainage line that is feeding the Umlilwati, a small tributary. but there's water flowing here, and it has been excavated by the elephants. They've dug this, it's probably about 3.5 feet deep, just over a meter, and you can see there is water there, and that water will be flowing, and I'm certainly not going to drink any of it. Apparently it smells pretty rank, but it's much cleaner, for example, than the water that's in the Djuma Dam pan, which of course is filled with buffalo dung and urine and the detritus of various sort of terrapins and various other things. So this is where the elephants will choose to come and drink as the dry season progresses. Right, I think the lions are moving again. Let's head across to them.
Mornings don't get much better than watching a male lion in this glorious golden morning light. The two of them have settled down in a sunny patch to warm themselves up and have a jolly good clean. Now, Bethany, sorry, I was trying to concentrate on following those lions and making sure we knew where they went, and I didn't fully get to your question, which was, would they be looking for another member of their coalition, or another member of the coalition now that they've lost one of them? And the answer is no, probably not. It's not unheard of for a male lion coalition to accept a member after the coalition is formed, but it is very unusual. And the chances are that the Birmingham Boy Coalition will forever after now be four, unless something else happens to one of the other males. What I do think might, well, I've put it forward as conjecture more than anything else, is the possibility that with down to four, they are quite severely weakened as a coalition, and that might have been one of the reasons why the Matimbas felt brave enough to not quite go into the heart of their territory, but at least to take a little sojourn into being close to that area. I like this one lion. He's got a mane all the way down the front of his body, but hardly anything around the back. He looks very scraggly. There you go, the usual affection between coalition members, and plus, of course, the added advantage of passing on scents. Putting one lion's scent onto the other. Kathy in Tennessee, you were wondering about how many males there are in the coalition. The answer is four now within the Birmingham Boys. He looks so reluctant. I love the mohawk, by the way. Not the most dignified pose. Kathy, there's four in the Birmingham Boy Coalition. There are two males in the Sulati Male Coalition that are further to the north. Oh, he looks like he's really enjoying that scratch. Coalition of four, it used to be five, it is now four, are the dominant males in this area for now. You can sort of see what I mean by a large coalition having to split off into different groups. So when the larger a coalition's territory, the further they have to go to patrol, and the more they have to split up in order to do so successfully and to maintain the size of that territory. And a lion on his own or in a pair is a lot more vulnerable than they would be in a group of four. But to maintain their territory, it would be simply impossible for them to stay together all the time. Oh, the Birmingham boy is looking a little bit the worse for the wear, actually. Okay, boys, where are you leading us now? Let's see if we can't stay with them. It does get very thick in this block. Hopefully we can find a nice game path to follow. Or maybe Taxi will make one for us. Let's try go this way. I actually think I suspect they're going to come out close to the road. I might leave them for now, disappearing into this block, because you can see how thick it is up ahead of us. And go around across to the road and see if we can't meet up with them from there. I don't know. Sorry, I have to make space. I have to wait here for the moment because there's only space for one of us to go ahead. I don't know how much thicker it's going to get, but I think it's going to be very difficult for us to keep up with them through this block. Uh-oh, it's not block taxon in. Watch out, Chandra. The leopards asked an interesting question while we sit here, because I cannot follow through here. I'll have to wait for my turn to go around. Leopold, you're wondering if the lions get uncomfortably cold at night. And I guess they do. They certainly will feel cold, just like all of the animals out here, but at least they've got each other to cuddle together for warmth. A leopard, on the other hand, would have to find a nice cozy spot all to themselves and try and be warm there. No colder than the other animals, but at least there's some shared body warmth, generally. I'm going to try and get back out onto the road and follow up on these lines. While I do, let's head back over to Sam.
Uh-oh. So, exciting morning with the lions. Myself and Dave at the moment are in an open area. We thought we heard something in the thickets here, so we're just going to drive pretty slowly and see if we can see anything that might be lying up in the tall grass here. Have a look at that nice light on these trees though. It looks very cool, that morning light. So two male lions this morning, jeepers, so all sorts is happening. We're going to see if we can find you something around these areas. Doesn't seem to be anything up here from what we heard. But we're going to go and make our way towards Cheetah Plains, see if we can find some cheetah this morning. It is a cold morning, and as we know, the cheetah are diurnal animals. So what we thought we'd do is just have a look in our property to see if there's something that might be lurking around, whether it be leopard tracks or lion, female lion tracks, because we know that the pregnant female is in the area somewhere. And there's no point really going to go look for her. We just thought maybe if we drive in that area and she's lying up on the road or close to the road somewhere, it would be nice to view her. So it was always worth the chance to see if we can see her. And it doesn't seem that she's here anywhere. But we can hear the smell of lion dung. It's quite prominent. And every now and then an alarm call coming from the deep thicket down there. So, interesting morning for lions this morning. You've seen some, we've smelt some. Maybe we'll see some as we drive around this corner. Susan would like to know if a lion was hungry and saw a nice juicy looking Sam and Dave in the car, would the lion come and try and eat us? No, Susan. No. It wouldn't happen. I mean, I've heard of it happening once before. I think it happened in the Kruger National Park. But it's lions are very scared of humans. And also, when we're in the vehicle, they don't see us as humans. As you can see, we are sitting with those male lions at the moment. And, they almost don't see us as a threat when we're in the car. So the car acts as like a barrier and gives us the opportunity to view lines. But we, if we were on foot trying to view those lines, it would be a much different story. Those lines would run away from us. So it's, I mean, it's a good question, but at this stage, no lines. Even if it was super hungry, wouldn't see us as food in the car. But to be honest, I don't know what they're thinking while they're lying down looking at us. I don't know if we look that juicy. What do you think, Dave? So let's go up the fire break to see if there's any tracks of any female lionesses walking in this area. And it's not common for female lionesses to stay in one area. They like to move. It's just that we've seen lionesses around before for quite some time now, at least a week and a half. So it's always worth just tracking and seeing what one can find in the early mornings. Have a look at this grass in the morning light. It actually looks really cool. I love the look of light as it is being caught by grass. Just looks incredible. So those are the top grasses which the zebra would like to graze. So zebra would come into these areas, much like other animals, rhinos and elephants and all that, will eat, and the big bulk grazers will eat the grass that we see and we've just shown you here. And the wildebeest like the much smaller grass, so they will come behind those grazers. So let's go back to Jamie to have a last look at those lions.
Our last view of these lions as they cross the road. We've got to make space for vehicles coming in to join us at the site, and we've managed to have one last view of them. Look at that mangy patch on his shoulder. Shame I could just hear poor Taxon trying to get out of this block. So we're going to stay with them for now, actually, until the other two vehicles arrive, at which point we will pass the sighting across to them. Beautiful in this morning light. They're on a mission. Okay, let's think about this. Give me 1 second. I just need to think about how to follow them. I know that there is a route into this block. All right, let's pop in here and try and catch up with them this way. Thanks, Tex. Okay, my turn to follow. Taxon kept track of them for me. Now it's my turn to keep track of them for him. In theory, there they go. We're struggling a little bit with Wendy's power situation at the moment. No, that's not going to work. Yeah. I'm sure you don't want to be with us while we crash through here, so I'm going to send you back over to James.
Hello everybody, I'm standing behind a silver cluster leaf bushel, but I am standing with what is known as the sword-toothed love grass. Isn't it lovely, Brian?
It is beautiful.
So beautiful. Yes. And it has the wonderful name Erogrostis superba. It is superb, isn't it, Brian?
Very superb.
Very superb. Now, quite apart from the silliness involved in this, these seeds are obviously an extremely valuable source of food for many things out here, especially rodents and birds like, what birds were I seeing eating them the other day? Some of the finch-like birds, so a manakin or a wax bill, or a... I'm just trying to think exactly. Oh, yes, I saw a cinnamon-breasted bunting, for example. What they would do, not so much with this one, although I'm sure they do that with this one, if you look at this grass here, which looks like a sort of small wheat, what they do is they fly up, they grab the grass, and they pull it down onto the ground, and then they put their foot over the top of it and use their beaks to pull the seeds off, and then they let it go and it flicks back up and ends up as it does there. Now, Aerogrostis is one of the very few genus of grasses that has produced an indigenous kind of African grain. Now, we all know that wheat and maize and barley are all grasses in the same way that these are, but that they have much larger seeds than just about all the African grasses. And for this reason, they were domesticated. Now, in Africa, very few grasses were domesticated. One of them was sorghum, and the other was something called Aerogrostis teff, which is a species of Aerogrostis like this, which grows up in the Ethiopian highlands. And teff, which is basically exactly like wheat, it's a sort of standard issue refined grain carbohydrate, has now become all the rage amongst the sort of organic eating, fashion eaters of the Western world, when in actual fact it's a fairly bland tasting grain from the highlands of Ethiopia that people only ate there because there was really not much else to eat. And that's from the same genus as this, Aerogrostis. Isn't that nice? It's not very nice, right? All right, on we go. We're in the block here, and excuse me one second. We're going to walk through here, and I'm just going to go and look around. Well, we're kind of in the general vicinity where Karula's been spending quite a lot of time. We'll just see what we can find there. I've got no idea where she is or what she's doing, but maybe we'll be lucky. In the meantime, Samuel has got a very large animal to show you.
So on our way to Cheetah Plains this morning, we came across some elephants that are walking towards our property. At the moment they're on Torchwood, and I just caught sight of a tusk through the trees in the distance there. And now I've already seen about 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 elephants that are here, and they'll all be coming into this area very soon. Here's one to the left here, in the sunlight there, so it's quite difficult to view, but we've got quite a number of them still coming through. There's a young Ellie there. So if we're lucky, we'll have all these elephants come past our vehicle. I'm just going to reverse so that we don't have the sun completely coming in that angle of our front. Just before these elephants cross over, we might be in for a very, very special treat of elephants walking right past our vehicle. I'm just going to be patient and give it time. So, that's good. So now we're actually in a little bit of shade now as well, so that'll help shade from that sun, so we can actually view the elephants. So it looks like he's grazing there on some round-leaf teaks, some bush willows, and the trees and the grasses are looking quite a little bit greener from those rains we had about 2 days ago. We've seen quite a few birds as well. When we were on Cheetah Plains yesterday, I saw a number of different birds that were feeding on insects. So the insects would have come out from the rains, and all the different mammals such as bush babies and birds have been coming out to collect some of the insects that have come from the rain. So that's very, very cool whenever it rains. And here looks like this elephant is playing with some dust. It looks awesome in that morning light with the dust just floating around. It looks like a young female from this position. That looks very cool. Oh, wow. See how she blew, what, yes, in that morning light, that is incredible. Isn't that spectacular? So they will be dust bathing themselves, and that helps them with cooling down when it gets a bit hotter a little bit later, and also helps them with the different parasites that like to jump on board with the ellies. And I also think they do it because it's... Ooh, look at that. So it is a female. You can see that by that quite rigid front of her head there. I'll explain the difference between a female and a male when we have a look at Elvis the Ellie a bit later. It can help us with learning a little bit more about females and males. And look, she's interested in who we are and what we are. The youngsters are coming behind her. Youngster, they're just behind her. Two young ones. So she just was interested to see who we are as the two youngsters came back. Look how she's flaring her ears out like that. Incredible sighting of these elephants this morning. Sorry about that view of the back of our vehicle. Pleasure to spend some time with some young elephants in the morning. On our way to Cheetah Plains. They really are such graceful animals, the elephants. Always just calming down wherever I'm on drive. Cool the tempo down. So wherever you are in the world, and you're watching these elephants walking around, I hope they're bringing you that same sense of calm. It's almost not a word for elephants, the kind of the emotion that they can bring. Very, very peaceful animals. Another elephant just through the thicket that's moving quite quickly. Seems that it could be another young female. She's also come and had a look at us. There's even more coming. This is quite a big herd of breeding. Look what she's doing. She's shaking her ears. Anna Marie is asking, do elephants sneeze? You know, Anna Marie, I've watched them more, especially because they kick up all the dust, as you mentioned. Yes, I've seen an elephant sneeze before. It's quite funny. Sneeze were just trumpeted really loud. Oh, look at that. That's awesome. What are you doing? Incredible interaction between two young elephants. This one doesn't even have tusks yet. I love how playful the young elephants can be with one another. Her trunk right over her body. So the mother's just in the background there with the two youngsters here. We were sitting down. We were sitting earlier looking at the grasses, looking at that beautiful light in the grasses, and now you can see that again. You can see them now grazing on those grasses, picking them up. Eating the little plants that are on the ground as well. What's also really interesting is that sometimes you'll find elephants will eat ground, some of the ground, like I find little bits of ground, and that's called geophrasia. And they're collecting and eating some of the minerals that they find in the ground. If they're lacking in some mineral, they'll eat some of the ground, which is truly interesting. You also get coprophagia, which is some animals that eat. Ooh, look at that, reaching up for some plants in the distance there. Coprophagia is when you find some animals eat the dung of other animals to collect minerals. So there's truly everything that can be eaten out here in the bush. Now I can really see the size of those tusks and that skin and the size of the ears. I love the skin of elephants. There's a great shot of the two youngsters together. And as we sit here in silence for a bit, you could pick up on the different sounds of these elephants eating, browsing. The two youngsters seem to be playing with each other over here. This interaction between these two youngsters is awesome. There's a little bit of a fight going on just in the distance there with two elephants. Look at that. Isn't that awesome to see that through the thicket there? And they're not small, they're... Listen to that. Look at the two youngsters coming out here now. There seems to be a little bit of unrest. The large one here seems to be another female. She's coming to have a look at us. Smelling us. Look at that little bump on top of the head of the one on the right there. What is that on top of its head? Can you see that there? No, the one to the left. It's gone now. And there was some... This one, yeah. It's just behind that tree there. There was something on top of its head. I don't know if anyone else saw that. It looked like a little rock or something on top of one of the elephant's heads. Look at the interaction here again between the two youngsters. Beautiful sounds of the bush. Another alien here. Breeding herd seems to be getting larger and larger, as we can still hear elephants coming in from all different directions. There's two that are now coming in behind that one there. This is such a magnificent sighting of elephants. Oh, look at the small one there. That's very sweet. William is curious to know if I've ever had an elephant come up to the vehicle and touch my vehicle. Yes, William, I've had that quite a few times. Probably about 3 or 4. And they just touched it and then left straight away. So I just felt it very quickly with their trunk. But you can always kind of see what kind of mood they're in. If they're in a curious mood and they just want to see what you might be, or if they're in an angry mood, and that's when you don't want them to come anywhere close to your vehicle. It's all about... While we sit for a bit longer with these elephants, let's go and see a ground hornball with Jamie.
Here's a wonderful surprise while we've been playing hide and seek, where poor Taxon is trying to guide all of us into a sighting and none of us can find him. We've been surprised by a sighting of 3 ground hornbills. How wonderful. The 2 of them there foraging together. Looks like a male in front and a female behind. Grabbing at insects and whatever else they can find. I'm just going to take this opportunity for one moment to just be quite quiet and see if I can hear Taxon coming through the bushes. Well, these ground hornbill are going to disappear relatively quickly. Lovely to see them on these open clearings once again. It's been a while since I last saw a ground hornbill on Djuma. We've seen them relatively regularly on Cheetah Plains.
Very good, and yeah, Tax 2, well, I think this road bent out to the east a little bit.
Poor Mike is trying to find Taxon. I'm also trying to find Taxon.
I didn't get audio there now either.
I'm just listening really, really carefully to hear if I can help these guys out, because they are trying to find him. So ground hornbill, that huge bird, I know it's difficult for you to see exactly how big that sort of bird is, but it's about just a little bit larger than a turkey in terms of size, just to give you a sense of scale, and critically, critically endangered. So you're looking at 3 of only 4,000, no, sorry, not 4,000, that's too high. You're looking at 3 of about 1,500 left in the entire world of those birds. So something that we're always exceptionally excited to see. I'm just going to go around the corner here. I'm sure Taxon's going to pop out. He said the males seem to be looking for something quite keenly. We'll see if we can't figure out what that is. Shampoo Taxon was just keeping track of them so that we could guide the other vehicles in before we both left.
But there's a Yari just more to the south of me.
While we try and find Taxon, I'm going to send you back across to Sam and his elephants.
So we are still with this huge breeding herd of elephants, and we just saw 2 elephants in the background there that were fighting. It's incredible to see that. Maybe we'll see them get stroppy with each other again. So there was a little bit of animosity between those 2 in the distance there. The other one doesn't seem interested at all. Ooh. Have a look at that.
two elephants that are fighting down there. Just in the distance there, we can see a bit of dust. Let's see if I can drive in that direction to see what's going on between these two elephants. How awesome was that? You just saw the one elephant come in and start. Oh, we've still got all these elephants to the left of us, so I don't want to scare the youngster that's on our left, just so that we can go watch an elephant fight. Let's just give it some time. Maybe they'll come back on the road, but see, there they go. So I just saw them running into the thicket there. There's two running there. So we're not sure where they're going now. It's into the sun where they are, so these elephants have all of a sudden started to run over here. This is really interesting. It could have been the interaction between two different breeding herds. But you couldn't see the ones that ran down here. So what I'm going to do is just going to drive down here to see if maybe they come out of the bush again. Wow, it was incredible in the distance. I just saw one of these elephants sprinting after the other. You can still see a little bit of the dust that's here. The sun is directly ahead of us as we look to find these elephants, so it's not going to be easy. What I'll do is I'll go down to that termite mound and then do a loop to see if they run back onto the road somewhere here, because they are going to be following that breeding herd, so they will be back at some point. Just trying to locate on them. I think I see them. So some of you would have been commenting on the tracker collar that they saw on the female elephants. I didn't actually see that. Did you see it, Dave? I think I didn't quite see that tracking collar. I'm not sure if it was one of the elephants that has already gone through the bushes. We could have had another good look at it. Good look at it. These elephants were here, so their tracks are running into there. We're going to turn around here and see if maybe they've come back, will be coming back the other way. Sandy's interested into why they are fighting and do they ever injure each other. Sandy, they do injure each other sometimes in these fights, you know, as they are very, very big animals. And as you saw, they were bumping heads quite strongly there, but they are very resilient to those fights, and sometimes it can be a playful fight that they're having with one another between two young males, but it could also be two breeding herds that have interacted with each other, some of the females getting a little bit protective of their family groups, so it could also be that. But that was fascinating behavior that we just saw there between those two elephants. It's not often that you see two ellies having a rumble with each other. So we're just going to drive slowly and see if we can see them. So while we slowly drive across here to see if we can find those elephants that are fighting again, let's go and see how James is doing.
We are finding various bits and pieces out here. Sounds like great excitement with the elephants. This, of course, was not an elephant. It was, at one stage, a proud member of the family Bovidae, a large buffalo bull that was killed by lions, obviously not too far from here. What I shall do, in fact, let's stand up into the sun there, Brian. Let me turn it around for you so that you might see it in all its glory. And all of these bits and pieces on the end of this vertebra have names, which I don't know, but it is astonishing how many complicated pieces there are just on this one vertebra. And why it should have been like that, is all down to the incredibly random nature in which nature has developed. So my stick has gone through the spot where the cerebrospinal fluid would go, and the vertebrae, of course, are joined. You can see this one here. That would have been joined to its opposite number in much the same way that, well, the back end like that one is. So this buffalo, I don't know, I don't remember a kill being around here, do you? Brian, do you remember a murder around here? Anyway, buffalo died around here. I'd say this is a good, it's not that old, it's probably about 5 or 6 months old, I'd say. And I think it was a fully grown buffalo bull and must have been killed by a fairly substantial group of lions. We're not too far from Treehouse Dam, so I don't know who killed it or when that happened. But if you ever touch something like this in the bush, of course, one of the most important things to do, Brian, is...
wash your hands.
Yes, or disinfect yourself. Now, we came across this over here, and you can see these very nondescript kind of plants here, and I've never known what they were, but I have always realized that they smell of camphor, and if you squash them up at the roots, they've got a very sort of menthol camphor smell, and it's really nice. So apparently it is a bit of a disinfectant, so you can kind of rub that on your hands if you've been playing around with the bones, dead bones. I wouldn't then go and lick my hands, but maybe it would help a little bit. But Steph has just told me that they were used, or they still are used, by bushmen who, and I don't know if you know what a bushman is. A bushman is a kind of Stone Age person that lives up in the Kalahari. There are still people living as they did thousands of years ago. And they will take a plant like this to plug the ostrich eggs in which they transport water. Very nice. Well done, Brian. And they'd make, it's a sedge, so it makes a little ball of flour when there's enough water. It's much more stronger, much stronger smelling when there is some water. Right, let us go around. Now, we have, in the last little while, been trying to find, we've been trying to kind of get sight of the mystic boer, Stefan. And we're putting together a series where we spot him, and he doesn't know that we've spotted him. And I can't actually see him, but he's gone down here somewhere. This is our security detail, everybody. No, we will keep an eye out for him, though. Now, Judy H., you'd like to see some wild saffron. Yes, we can try and find some. There isn't any in this particular area, but as soon as we find some, I will let you know. And you see how the sun has warmed us up a little bit, how the lovely rays are touching our faces, and it is just one of the best feelings in the world. Careful there, Brian. Don't fall over anything. Oh, there.